In 2011, a British academic team announced the discovery of a hoard of more than 24 lead books, or codices, in Jordan. The academic team suggested the Jordan codices might be ancient and shed light on early Christianity and Judaism. But Dr. Peter Thonemann dismissed the entire hoard as a modern forgery.
A classical scholar at Oxford University, Thonemann made his views clear in private in an article for the TLS and on the BBC.
So sure, in fact, he staked his career on it. But his intervention has hindered the study of the codices. In this clip, I'm not attempting to answer what the lead books are. Instead, with the help of eminent Hebrew experts, I will focus on the competence of Thonemann's analysis. Thonemann's dismissal of the Jordan codices hoard is based on a photograph of a copper codex. He presents several arguments. He begins by appealing to the authority of an expert paleographer whom, Thonemann claims, pronounced the lead books as obvious fakes. Then he argues that the inscriptions on the tablet are clearly the work of an illiterate author. Next, he says, the author did not know the Greek language, since he does not distinguish between the letter lambda and alpha. Both are simply represented by the shape of the lambda. Also, much of the text is unintelligible. Literally translated, it means without grief, farewell, Abgar, also known as Asion. It's a meaningless sentence. Ergo, another telltale sign that the copper book is a forgery. What's more, the inscription has been badly copied from a museum artifact in modern times in the last 20 to 50 years. His next argument is that the forger's repertoire includes symbols copied from ancient Greek and Judean coins. Finally, if the copper codex is a forgery, then the dozens of lead books are also forgeries. I stake my career on it, he states confidently. Well, let's look at each of Thonemann's arguments closely. He starts with an appeal to the authority of André Lemaire, a world-renowned expert on paleography. Lemaire's opinion of the lead books was published by the Jewish Chronicle in its edition of March 3, 2011. Lemaire said that the lead books are, quote, a question apparently of sophisticated fakes. In the TLS edition of April 8, 2011, Thonemann claims that the Jewish Chronicle article reported that professional scholars had pronounced the lead books as obvious fakes. Clearly, Thonemann here is referring to the Jewish Chronicle's Lemaire quote about sophisticated fakes, since this is the only use of the word fakes in the Jewish Chronicle's article. But notice how Thonemann has dropped Lemaire's careful use of the keywords question and apparently. And Lemaire's sophisticated fakes has become, in Thonemann's article, obvious fakes. According to the Oxford Dictionary, the word sophisticated means developed to a high degree of complexity, so that Lemel's sophisticated fakes means virtually the opposite of Thonemann's obvious fakes. To know Lemel's actual position, we turn to his personal colleague, metallurgist Robert Favre.
I have Lemel's full report, and it's very detailed. He spent a long time studying the material and came up with a very detailed analysis of what some of the translations might be. But he was confused by some of the terms which he'd not recognized. I do not see that in any place did he say that these were definitely fakes. He never says that. He's unable to come to any definitive conclusion. That was his statement, that particular quote that you've given of Lemel. He never said that.
In fact, from a copy of Lemel's actual report supplied by Robert Favre, we learn that not only has Thonemann misrepresented Lemel's Jewish Chronicle quote, but the Jewish Chronicle's own wording does not accurately reproduce Lemel's words. Lemel concludes his written report with not one, but two possibilities remaining open.
Professor André Lemel came to the conclusion that taking into account these various remarks, one can hesitate between two interpretations. The first one, the inscriptions and the lead sheets could date from the 2nd century AD. A second conclusion is that the inscriptions and the lead sheets are a sophisticated fake made at some time during the last two centuries. He said we've got to be open-minded about this. They may be the most significant pieces of metal inscriptions that we've ever discovered, and possibly the first ever examples of writing in the form of a codex. His opinion hasn't changed. He's not sure whether they're genuine or not. But he certainly never said they aren't genuine. He hasn't, you know, he's not the kind of man to do that anyway. He's an expert on coins and ancient artifacts, one of the world's greatest, and inscriptions on artifacts. But he's also very, very cautious, and he's never... He didn't come back to me and say, these are forgeries, these aren't genuine. He's never said that. He's never said that in writing.
So what of Thonemann's substantive arguments?
First, Thonemann claims the author is illiterate. Therefore, he or she must be a forger. This doesn't follow. In antiquity, illiterate authors often inscribed artifacts.
Plenty of ancient inscriptions were made by people who probably were actually illiterate. It isn't necessary for a mason or an inscriber to actually know the language. What they usually do is copy it out from an exemplar or whatever. It's certainly a really curiously wrong argument for anybody that's supposed to know about paleography to claim the copper scroll, for example, from Qumran cave 3, almost certainly written by somebody who was illiterate. Very common.
J.T. Millick himself, right, when he published on the Qumran copper scroll, his opinion was that the metal workers were illiterate. Right. Al Walters today, another expert on the copper scroll, is of the same opinion. They're illiterate because they don't make clear distinctions between various Hebrew letters, which are very similar.
Thonemann Thonemann claims the author does not know his Greek. He transcribes the letter alpha incorrectly. Instead of giving the letter a cross stroke, he omits it so that it reads as a lambda. That is an error only a forger would make. But Thonemann is assuming that ancient Greeks only ever wrote the letter alpha with a bar. An elementary knowledge of ancient Greek shows that Thonemann is plainly mistaken.
Now, Thonemann says that he leaves out the crossbar on all of the alphas, but this is incorrect. If you look at the codex itself at the right end, you will see that one of the alphas has a crossbar.
And three more distinct alphas can also be seen at the bottom of the codex.
We have an early 2nd century Common Era manuscript of Homer's Iliad, where the scribe, even on the single lines, writes his alphas sometimes with and sometimes without crossbars. This is an attested phenomenon. Any Greek student, if they're going to study paleography and epigraphy, should learn at an introductory level that we do have alphas without crossbars. E.M. Thompson's Introduction to Greek and Latin Paleography, published by Oxford in 1912, it's filled with your classic textbook tables showing you how the different letters in Greek and Latin were formed in the different time periods. This is a pretty glaring example of overlooking something that one learns at an introductory level in Greek.
Thompson remarks that the Homeric scribe's inconsistency must be regarded only as affectations of the scribe. One might say the same of the Jordan tablet's mixture of alphas with and without crossbars. Thonemann says the inscription is meaningless, therefore it must be a forgery. It's a seductive argument, but an unintelligible inscription does not necessarily make it a forgery. It may be that the unintelligibility is deliberate.
Oh, there's an enormous number of ancient amulets and incantation bowls and so on with meaningless, Jewish ones, for example, with apparently meaningless terms and phrases on them. Indeed, the effect of something as magical is much clearer if the words and the writing being used don't make any sense. That's what makes it magical.
There are the mandaic magic bowls. No one disputes their authenticity. Right? The meaningful text is combined with what scholars call pseudoscript. The magician, if you will, wants to impress the client. Some New Testament apocrypha contains prayers in pseudo-Hebrew, Babel. Right, but it was their impression of what Hebrew might sound like. Right? And no one disputes that those texts are ancient apocryphal texts. So that in itself is no kind of proof of modern forgery.
In his TLS article, Thonemann also informs us that he successfully identified the copper book's Greek inscription as being from an ancient Nabatean Greek funeral monument of 108 to 9 CE on display in a Jordan museum over the last several decades. Thonemann inferred that therefore the copper codex must have been created in recent decades by a forger who had seen and copied the Greek inscription at the Jordan Museum. First, in a private email, he claimed it was forged in the last 20 years. This was oddly changed to the last 50 years in a version of the same email Thonemann released for online publication. Then, in his article in the TLS, he repeats it was forged in the last 50 years. However, although the copper artifact may or may not be modern, Thonemann overlooked the alternative possibility that already in ancient times someone, such as an Abgar family member, for example, could have copied a portion of the inscription onto a copper plate, perhaps out of apotropaic or memorial motives. Thonemann also points out that on the copper book,
The Apkar inscription begins with regular forward writing and ends in reverse writing and mirror letters. Thonemann pronounced this gibberish, but in fact, the presence of forward and reverse writing together is a well-known textual trait found on ancient amuletic artifacts associated with graves. Many such examples of this are discussed by Joseph Navet in his 1988 article, Lamp Inscriptions and Inverted Writing, in the Israel Exploration Journal. The copper book's form of the Apkar inscription is therefore congruent with known ancient precedents. Not only that, but its use of the letter alpha without crossbar is a practice attested for precisely the same era as the grave monument's date. Moreover, many historians believe Nabateans joined the Jewish revolt against Rome in the 130s CE, just a few decades after when the Apkar monument inscription was created. Perhaps the presence of both Nabatean and Jewish traits on the copper book reflect such a time of multicultural syncretism. Thonemann's fifth argument in favor of forgery concerns the imagery on the copper codex. He claims that the forger's repertoire includes symbols copied from ancient Greek and Judean coins. Thonemann assumes use of coin imagery means modern forgery. But authentic ancient lead coffins contain images also found on ancient coins. Thonemann himself does not elaborate on the copper book's images, but several bloggers have. One of the contested images is the crocodile. Blogger William Hamlin wrote that he was unaware of any, quote, ancient object that would create this impression, and he was suspicious of its strongly articulated scales. Hamlin mockingly suggested that it was made by a modern plastic children's toy. In fact, the copper book's crocodile image matches the overall design and the precise length, 64.5 millimeters, of an authenticated Roman bronze crocodile brooch dated to the 2nd to 3rd century CE. Hamlin's web reference to the crocodile image has recently been deleted. But the claim is still repeated by other bloggers. Other contested images on the copper book are those of a quadriga, a chariot drawn by four horses, and of Heracles. Several bloggers claim the images match those found on modern forged coins. But if the bloggers were so glaringly wrong about the codex's crocodile image, why should anyone trust what they say about the codex's other images? As these examples show, modern coin forgeries can look very similar to authentic ancient coins. Telling them apart is something that should be left to careful analysis by dispassionate and expert numismatists, not by bloggers with their minds already made up. Finally, on the basis that the copper codex is a forgery, Thonemann dismisses the whole hoard of lead books as fakes. Any scholar would have told Thonemann
that it is unwise to jump to such a conclusion.
It was a very foolish and unscholarly thing that was done to dismiss the entire lot without having seen them or examined them. I can't think of anybody who would regard that as scholarly.
So on the basis of codices, which are very unlike the other images that we see in the nearly 500 high-resolution photographs of the Jordan Lead Books, not copper, he applied that to the entire collection. Ergo, all of these artifacts are modern forgeries. That's a huge leap in logic, in my opinion.
Thonemann did not physically handle any of the lead books or inspect the hundreds of high-definition images. So what do experts who have say?
It's pretty much what you'd expect from something a couple of thousand years old.
Peter Northover is a world authority on ancient metals, and it was a detailed report, about eight or nine pages. He sent some of the samples to Switzerland for mass spectroscopy. So we had a profile of the chemical composition. With that, Peter Northover concluded, the analysis of the two samples taken showed compositions consistent with a range of ancient lead. The corrosion in the surface has built up over a period of time, making it clear that the book is not a recent production. It was pretty convincing that they were at least ancient material and certainly not modern forgeries. The corrosion that we examined rule out the possibility of it being less than 100. It can take at least several hundred years, the kind of corrosion that I saw on the ones at Oxford.
The patina is extremely complex on a number of different objects. You've got multiple types of patina. You've got corrosion. You've got accretion of minerals and soil. You've got items that are buried deep within, inside the holes even, which you wouldn't expect to see on a modern piece of lead. It tells us that these objects weren't created, you know, yesterday and then painted with a paint or a colouring to make them brown and grey and white. This one has mainly accretions on it. It's got lots of build-up of different coloured sandy, minerally calcified substances to the extent that you can barely see the pattern on it. And in some cases, when you zoom right in to the size of one of these rings, you're seeing an accretion of limescale that looks like the sort of stuff you see from stalagmites and stalactites, which has resulted from water dripping over a long period of time onto the surface and then evaporating to leave the minerals behind. Stalagmites and stalactites take tens of thousands of years per few inches, so that is certainly multiple centuries and possibly millennia, more than 1,000 years.
If we have good reason not to dismiss the lead books, what can we say about the copper codex? How does it compare with the lead books? At first sight, the copper book appears very different to the lead books. The front cover with the crocodile has no parallel in the lead books, and that could arouse suspicion that it is modern, but that doesn't follow.
Just because something doesn't have a parallel, right, doesn't mean that we should jump to a conclusion and speak in absolute terms. We should be very careful.
In fact, the reverse of the copper book shares a number of features with the lead books, which suggest it might well be old. The image on the back of the copper book is that of a Torah shrine, and it resembles in several respects those images excavated in ancient synagogue ruins throughout the 20th century in the Middle East. There's a lead version of the Torah shrine, which is clearly old. It shows pitting, cracking, and other convincing signs of age. So So that suggests that the copper book with a similar Torah shrine image is part of the same family of metal books. At first glance, the copper codex's wire too appears to be modern double-stranded wire. Now this in itself would not prove that the copper plate is modern, since modern wire could have been added recently to a genuinely old artifact. However, upon closer inspection, many of the wires of Mr. Saida's copper books do not appear to be perfect modern machine double-stranded wire. Finally, in favor of the probable old age of the copper codex is its appearance. To the untrained eye, its shiny appearance suggests it's a modern artifact. But artifacts known to be centuries and even thousands of years old can look equally shiny, such as this Syrian brass bowl now housed at the David Museum in Denmark, or these more than a millennium old copper plates. Moreover, a measure of Thonemann's undue haste are the results of an alpha spectroscopy test carried out in 2016 at the University of Surrey. Modern lead emits radioactivity in the form of the isotope lead-210. So an experiment was carried out on two Jordanian lead books to measure the presence of radioactive alpha particles.
Well, I understand that these books, it was alleged that they were modern so-called fakes or forgeries. They were created in the modern times after 1950. And so we thought that we would start with the simple test as to whether the radioactivity that modern lead shows is visible on these samples. We're set up for alpha spectroscopy here. So we're looking at single atoms, okay? So we're looking for single radioactive decays that occur in the artifact in question.
Specifically, the test measured the yield of alpha particles at 5.3 mega electron volts. According to Surrey, after 200 years, that is about 10 half-lives of lead isotope 210, it drops to zero. In other words, if the lead was produced within the last 200 years, it will emit radioactive alpha particles at 5.3 mega electron volts. If it's 200 years old or more, it won't. The results were unambiguous. The lead books showed no signs whatever of alpha particles.
So it's quite sensitive, and we counted for a long time. We waited for 4 days, and we didn't see anything above background.
In contrast to Thonemann's claim of production in the last 20 to 50 years, Jane states categorically of the Surrey lab test.
It excludes modern things, modern artifacts.
Whatever a future test might say about the age of the copper book, it cannot be applied to the lead books. Moreover, in the light of the recent Surrey test on two lead books, it would be equally premature to assume that the copper book is less than 50 years old. About 6 of the lead books contain the same Edgar inscription seen on the copper book. And one of the two lead books tested by Surrey is comparable in many respects to the lead books with the Apgar inscription. Moreover, the copper book's back cover contains a Torah shrine depiction found in some of the lead books with the Apgar inscription. Also, some of the lead books with the Apgar inscription contain designs matching some of the designs on the copper crocodile page. And lastly, there is some overlap in design between the copper crocodile book and one of the lead books tested by Sari. Since the lead book has been shown not to be a modern artifact, it is now more likely that the copper book is not a modern artifact either.
I would say that the artifacts, it seems very unlikely that the artifacts are less than 50 years old.
Needless to say, until lab tests are carried out, the age of the copper book cannot be confirmed. But what is clear is that Dr. Thonemann was premature in rushing to dismiss it as an obvious fake.
It was obviously a hasty reaction. And this has caused delays, possibly loss of precious material. An older scholar would have been much more cautious. So, yes, I think he was very unwise to speak on the basis of so little evidence.
This is not the place to say what the netbooks are. Only time will tell. But one thing is already abundantly clear. Whether the Jordan codices are ancient, medieval or modern, it's clear that they cannot be forgeries.
You cannot say something's a forgery unless you know that it's trying to imitate something. A forgery is an imitation. Rather imitating an actual existing text or we're imitating somebody's style. These cannot be said to be imitations of anything we know. Therefore, clearly, they are certainly not forgeries. The issue is whether they are of modern origin or ancient. And in either case, the question is, what are they? And I think Thonemann has already decided that they are modern. But in order to do that, you have to show clearly that they can't be ancient. He hasn't done that.
It's entirely possible that some of them may be ancient, some of them may be from a later medieval period. One could also say that, well, let's even look at the infamous crocodile codex. Why could it not have been copied in ancient times, for whatever reason? It could be an authentic piece of art. It could be some type of amuletic device from the modern period. I mean, people still use amulets in the Middle East today. So the idea of forgery, that requires more proof than we have at hand.
Thonemann's glaring errors should be a warning that only those qualified to comment should do so.
I would have thought for the majority of these artifacts, expertise in classics would be not necessary, but nice if you had it. Primarily, it is knowledge of Hebrew and the Jewish roots of Christianity and all the things that are implied by the images. And even if on first sight the letters seem to say nothing that is obvious, the images say a very great deal to people who actually know the field.